Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this next in this series on the Bench Power Supply Project. Now, I kind of reached that point where I'm trying to troubleshoot the circuit to make sure I've got the circuit diagram correct. And what I was thinking I was going to do was just offline without the video, basically work on it, get the circuit diagram sorted out, get a working circuit on the breadboard, and then come back and we'd start making adjustments and see how it hangs all together. But then I suddenly realized there's potentially a bit of learning that may be missed because I, for one, don't think I've done things quite the best or most proper way. For one, this circuit diagram that I've got noted on this book, it's not laid out in the most logical fashion. There is an input side here, but the output is sitting in the middle of the circuit diagram. So it's not the easiest to follow. The one or two mistakes I found, I've been rubbing out the pencil and kind of making corrections on the sheet. And it'd be far easier if I did have it in a CAD program where I could make address mistakes far easier and make it far easier to follow. The other issue I'll show you on the bench in terms of the actual breadboard and the layout. Right, so the other thing I've kind of looked to myself and said I could do far better, and I did mention this before in a T4D, is that on this circuit board, you'll see it's a very small cramped circuit board, so I want to get a bigger circuit board which will give me more room to work on. And I've been using these kind of interconnect wires. Now, it looks a bit messy and it makes it rather difficult when you're trying to troubleshoot because you're trying to carefully push the wires aside, try and test certain measurement points. So what I've elected to do, because I did buy a bigger breadboard and it came with these flat type connecting wires. Now, I've never used these before, but when I have seen them used, it does seem a far nice, neater solution. You kind of do have to obviously use the predetermined length, so this will be a first for me, but I think it'll be neater and make troubleshooting far easier. So then once I've got the circuit in CAD and I've transferred it onto a bigger board and it looks neater, I'll then be in a position that if it doesn't work straight off, which is probably going to be the case, I can go back and because I've got the power supply over here with obviously a working circuit, I can power this up carefully. Obviously it's open up, there's mains exposed, so I need to be careful, but I can then take reference measurements from this and then correlate and check back to troubleshoot the circuit. It'll also be helpful that once we've finished, what I can do is I can have a set of reference voltages at certain points to aid troubleshooting in the future if anything goes awry. And for instance, the one thing which has been on my mind was, let's say for instance, I've got a problem and the circuit isn't working. Is my op amp little IC working? And what I can do is obviously pop it straight off the breadboard and straight into the circuit on the power supply over here and double check that that functionality works okay. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna go away, I'm gonna put the circuit in CAD, neaten up the breadboard, and then once I get that up, I'll walk you through the troubleshooting process where I reference back to the actual original circuit and we get it up and running on the breadboard.
It is a day later, and what I've done, I've used DesignSpark, and I've used DesignSpark because it is a product that I used before. In fact, I set out the electronic DC load in DesignSpark previously. So again, without going through any real tutorials or helps, I just kind of jumped into it and kind of fumbled my way through it, but it certainly wasn't too difficult to use. I certainly do want to try the other packages so I can make a recommendation or understand what's the easiest and the pros and cons of the various PCB design packages. So it's a far cry from my spaghetti junction. And by going through this whole process of laying it out in a kind of CAD program, it's also helped me uncover a few other mistakes I made. Now, I'm also all for putting pen or pencil to paper just to get something down, but obviously this doesn't provide a lot of flexibility and can potentially look fairly messy when you're starting off. Making changes is very difficult. And here, obviously, I've been able to lay this out in more logical fashion. I've got the kind of the input side from the AC, the transformer, bridge rectifier, got the filtering over here, right through to kind of the transistor side of it. I've got the op amp packages here doing their bit, and then out to the output side over here. Now, I'm still gonna go through this and double check it. So that's why I'm not gonna really show you or present a proper final design yet. I'm going to now lay this out on the breadboard, hopefully in a fashion which will make it easy to see, more logical to trace. And then if we do have any problems, once I've got it set up on the breadboard again, we can then easily troubleshoot it and compare it to the actual working circuit. But anyway, a lot of benefit from doing this. As I say, once I've got all this done, I'll provide a proper file with this so that folks can have a look at it. At the moment as well, although I have the values in there, which you won't be able to probably see clearly on the way I'm filming this, those values are original values which we will play with to make sure, for one, that we've got the safety margins we need on, let's say, things like capacitors, and also to see whether we can change things up a bit to improve the output. But we'll see whether that's possible or not. Right, so the next step I'm going to move to is laying it out again neatly on the breadboard.
Right then, so I'm in the process of laying everything out on a bigger breadboard, as I said I would do. And I've gone and pulled out all the silly wiry bits which make it more difficult to troubleshoot, and they can potentially be loose. And I'm using these kind of harder interconnects. So it's the first time I'm playing around with those, but so far it makes for a far neater layout on the board. Now, the one thing I just want to do mention for particularly novices like myself doing this, when you're working with components, it can also be tricky to understand, for one, pinouts of components. So I've gone ahead of time, obviously on the internet, I've laid out on a piece of paper, I've drawn up for myself the pinout of the transistors, the FETs and what have you, to make it easier when I'm putting things down on the board. I go and label, number the pins, obviously, and understand the orientation, again, to get it right when I get it on the board. The next, perhaps would seem like a silly but simple thing, is just, if you've got a whole lot of resistors, as I have got scattered out on the bench here, is to try and identify the right ones as you're trying to get the circuit together. Because that can be quite time consuming if you don't know what's going on. The one, when I say don't know what's going on, you might, if you don't have a or understand the resistor color code chart, which I've got over here, you're then going to use a multimeter and go, okay, now where is that 100K or where is that 4.7K, and go through each one of them trying to find out. Or if you're familiar, obviously, with the color code, you can try and read it off directly, but there's obviously, you get either four bands or a five band system, so that can sometimes be confusing. So what I do, I use a combination of both just to try and speed things up. I look and I see, right, I need a 4.7K. I go on the chart and I see, right, four. So four is going to be yellow. The first band is going to be yellow. And then that's what I look for. I don't have many resistors with a yellow band. I may have a couple of varying values. And then I just head for those with the multimeter, check the value, and it's far easier to find. So just a little tip, just a way that I'm doing it. If you have better suggestions, then do post them below, because I'm sure there are many folk who will be appreciate tips in terms of getting things like this together. Right then, so I've got it all laid out on the breadboard. I've got the fluke here on the output, which is across a capacitor here. I've got my power supply connected up, and no guesses that when I switch on the input power, I'm getting nothing on the output power. So I suppose no big surprise. It would have been a little miraculous had it worked first off after I've gone and re-put it on, but certainly it's a lot neater with these smaller links on the board. I am going to bring in closer once I start troubleshooting. I'm literally going to walk away from this at the moment. I'm going to have lunch. I'm going to come back after lunch, and then I'm going to start probing. First of all, without reference to the other power supply, I'm just going to probe and make sure that I've got the connections working. I did find, even when putting this together on the breadboard, one of the holes, one of the connectors on the breadboard was larger than it should have been, and it wasn't making connection with the actual op-amp package. So I had to move the op-amp package and avoid that pin. So those are the silly things that can trip you up. I have been kind of checking continuity along the way, but that's the thing I'll come and check once I get back from lunch. So I'll see you after lunch. Right then, so I'm back from lunch. So let me just tell you what I've been doing, a little bit of testing in the meantime. One of the first things I did, I've gone and got one of the pots connected up with those nice little grippy paws over there, because it's far easier if I'm trying to probe something and check a measurement and make an adjustment. Obviously the pot was moving around, so I've got it gripped nice and solidly. Then I went and started checking a few voltage points. I did have power to the op-amp package, but I wasn't confident that it was operating that. And what I wanted to do was just confirm that it was still operational. So I hooked it out. and exchange it for the one that's actually in my college power supply. So as that's in a IC holder over there, a DIP package holder, I just merely exchanged it, powered the power supply on, and it works. So I've switched them back. So at least I know that worked. So what I was doing, I had the college power supply powered up. It's still set for 220 volts. So I've got a step up converter over there. So I was powering it with AC, and then I was starting to take reference checkpoints, voltage points off this, and then do comparisons on my actual circuit on the breadboard. But of course, there are potentially two issues with that. For one, you've got to be careful because I'm working live. I've got 220 volts on the primary side of the transformer. And also, I've got AC coming in. So the waveform and the voltage measurements here are different because obviously I'm powering my breadboard directly with very clean DC. So I noticed that on the with this powered up with AC, there certainly was a little bit of noise even after the filtering, so I wasn't getting the exact voltages. As well, obviously, the voltage level that's coming off there, I was probably not exactly replicating with the DC power supply. I could have hooked up my AC transformer that I've got, but obviously it's a different transformer. So to make things alike and the same for the test, what I did was I've gone and disconnected the AC, and these two probes over here are coming from my DC power supply. And I've put them literally across where the DC would be coming in, and I'm powering the power supply up that way. So in that way, what I do is I'm applying exactly the same. I'm using 25 volts on my college power supply, which is what it'll operate happily off. And I've got another set of leads, which I disconnect because I don't want a common ground with my college power supply to confuse issues. So what I do is I go and check, I take readings of the working power supply. I then come up and I hook this one up, same voltage, so I can as closely as possible replicate the expected voltages between the two. And I've already found an issue, which is the next thing I'm going to have a look at. But just to show you, so at the moment, I've actually got it powered up. And you'll note at the front that the main voltmeter is not powered up. And that's because that was gaining its power from the secondary 5-volt circuit on the other side, which is not part of this project. So that is totally isolated. So that isn't powered up. But what I've done, I've got it connected. You can see I've got the leads coming out there. I've got it going to my electronic DC load. I'm not applying a load. I'm just actually using it as a voltmeter at the moment. So if I make adjustments on the knob, so as I turn the college supply knob on the front here, we can see that it's actually functioning. So that's what I'm using and doing at the moment to do those checkpoints. But I'll bring you in a little closer and I'll show you on the circuit diagram where I found my first issue. Okay, so let me just point out on the circuit diagram where I'm kind of trying to attack it first. Now, I've gone and checked the kind of obvious voltage points across the rails to make sure I've got the same 25 volts across the rails and that works out correctly. I've got nothing on the output on the breadboard. So the first place I'm attacking it is to see the voltage adjustment, which should obviously be setting a voltage. So forget about any current flow over here. I need to see a voltage on the output, which I'm not. So down here, we've got the two op amps. And then we've got over here, the one potentiometer, one 10K potentiometer, and the other one. Now this one over here adjusts the voltage. The other one adjusts the current. So at the moment, I'm not going to be looking at current adjustment because I don't even have a voltage or anything at the output. So I'm concentrating on the voltage side. Now, this pot has got the sweeper, in fact, goes to the positive side of this op amp. And then there's an output which obviously goes and drives on some transistors and other bits over here, which will obviously affect and set the voltage over here. So that's why I'm double checking what's going on over here. So my first check is to, for one, check the two inputs to this op amp. So I've got the positive and then the negative or the inverting side of this op amp. So I'm going to check the kind of behavior or voltage signals on both that positive and negative on the college power supply first, and then go to the breadboard and see what's happening there. I'll also then potentially, if that does work out, obviously then check the output to see that that's behaving as it should, to see the problem sitting kind of on what's driving this op amp, or whether it's further down the chain and in the circuitry over here. So just to give you a quick idea, on that op amp, it's obviously a dual inline package or DIP. It's got 8 pins, and just to quickly show you, it's got a supply, a negative supply on pin 4, positive supply on pin 8, and then you've got 2 op amp packages, and on my circuit diagram, I kind of labeled them bottom, which is this side, and then top. And you pin 1 here, O is for output, you've got your inverting and then non-inverting over here. And then on the top side, pin 5 is your non-inverting, pin 6 is your inverting, and then pin 7 is your output. So that's what I'm going to test. And I'm testing in reference to ground at this point in time. So what I've done on the actual power supply, I'll show you, I've got one lead pin clipped on ground. So that means it's easier to work with one hand probing where I want to with reference to ground while I adjust the pots. Right, so I've got the Sanwa multimeter here, which is what I'm using to pick up reference points and measurements on the college power supply. These two leads are obviously injecting the DC power supply in to actually run the board itself. And then I've got one of the Sanwa leads, the common, is hooked to the negative rail. So that's permanently there hooked on, so at least I only need to work with one hand. So I can then go and probe the points I want and then make adjustments on the pot, on the front, on the voltage adjustment pot. So that's what I'm going to do next. Right, so I'm sat on pin 5, which is the non-inverting side of that op amp. You can see the reading at the moment is 1.9 volts. So I'm just going to turn the pot down to the kind of 0 volt adjustment on the power supply, and we can see it goes down to going down to 0. And as I turn it up, you can see it comes up. Now I'm right to the top and we're just above 5 volts. So that voltage range on that non-inverting side is between basically 0, moving, looks like fairly linear, all the way up to about 5 volts. Okay, so that's the non-inverting side. I'm now going to move to the next pin, which is pin 6. And let's come down, and that is doing the same thing by the looks of things. There must be a capacitor that's discharging, but it's also going down to 0. And I'll come back up. There we go, and that goes to 5 volts. Okay, so those are both doing the same thing. Now the next pin, which is pin 7, is the output of that op amp. So that's when I'm right down at 0 on the pot. Come up, 1 volt. Okay, and that one, barring some movement, as I turn the pot, you can see it's obviously adjusting, the output's adjusting, but it's trying to maintain a 1 volt output. I say at the moment I don't fully understand the operation. That's something we'll look into once we know we've got the circuit working. We'll see how it all operates, but it's holding a 1 volt unless I go right down to the 0 side, the bottom adjustment on that pot. Right, so now we know how those behave. Let's check the breadboard. Right, so now we're at the breadboard, and again, what I'm doing to make life easier, I'm using a multimeter at each point, so I'm not switching back and forth. It's quick to switch between the different boards which are working or not. So I've got the Agilent here. I've also got it permanently hooked up with a lead down this point at the bottom of the screen here to the ground, and then that means I just have to use a single hand to probe. Now what I've gone and done, you'll just notice in shot here, I've just gone and added a knob onto that pot, because I was actually trying to do it with a screwdriver before because it was very difficult to grip the shaft. So that makes life a little bit easier. I can make the adjustments there. So I'm now going to power up this breadboard. And again, so I'm going to start off on the first pin, which is the non-inverting. So, okay, so there's 0.5 volt over there. Sorry, hands. Let's see if I can do this and still get everything in shot. Okay, interesting. So let me just go down to what I think is zero. So that's giving us about 0 volts. I'm going to adjust that up. So there's 5.3 already. And if I go all the way up, I'm getting 17.2. So there's something awry there. Okay, we'll go to the inverting side. And that is permanently at 16 volts, no matter what I'm doing on this pot. So there's certainly something awry there. We'll just go to the output. Nothing at the output. So that might explain why I'm getting nothing on the actual output side voltage, because although again I need to go into the proper operation of the circuit, I'm fairly confident that the output of that op amp will be driving and controlling the voltage level that's being set. So the voltages going into that op amp are wrong. So I've got to now backtrack and understand why that is. So I'll have a little poke around and then bring you back hopefully once I've resolved that.